Good morning. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Atlanta's live stream worship service. So glad you are here live with us. I am joined by one of our lay ministers, Dr. Tony Stringer, by our youth programs coordinator, Ayana Coffee Stringer, and laying down some sweet bass licks, Mr. Jeep Hook, our first hymn this morning. Is come and go with me to that land. I play one weird chord, it has a different melody note than it is in the hymnal, but you don't care. You'll catch it in the first verse, you'll get it by the last verse. This is come and go with me.
Come and go with me to that land. Come and go with me to that land. Come and go with me to that land. Where I'm bound, where I'm bound. Come and go with me to that land. Come and go with me to that land. Come and go with me to that land. Where I'm bound. They'll be singing in that land. They'll be singing in that land. They'll be singing in that land. Where I'm bound, where I'm bound. They'll be singing in that land. They'll be singing in that land. They'll be singing in that land. Where I'm bound.
There'll be freedom.
There'll be freedom in that land. There'll be freedom in that land. There'll be freedom in that land. Where I'm bound, where I'm bound. There'll be freedom in that land. That land, there'll be freedom in that land where I'm bound. There'll be justice in that land. There'll be justice in that land. There'll be justice in that land where I'm bound, where I'm bound. There'll be justice in that land. There'll be justice in that land. Justice in that land where I'm bound. Come and go with me to that land. Come and go with me to that land. Come and go with me to that land where I'm bound, where I'm bound. Come and go with me to that land. Come and go with me to that land. Come and go with me to that land.
Thank you all so much for being here. It is the best place to watch worship on the whole internet. It's a big internet.
Good morning. I'm Dr. Tony Stringer. Welcome to Sunday morning worship with the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Atlanta, a beloved community that changes lives. Wherever you're from, whomever you love, and whatever path you're on, you are welcome here. Check out UUCA's website and the emailed weekly update for up-to-the-minute news about our Sunday live-streamed worship, our exceptionally good enough Wednesdays, and other programs we'll bring right to your home. Attention parents with young children. We know the pandemic has created a unique situation for you, juggling more responsibilities every single day of the week. That's why UUCA is starting a parenting support group dedicated to sharing, listening, and cheering one another on during this unique and challenging time. If you're interested in taking part, please contact Kate Sweeney. Her email is going into the chat right now. And join us for the first virtual meetup Thursday, July 23rd from 7:30 to 9 p.m. We are excited to invite you to our Zoom room hour happening immediately following the service. If you've not already done so, please sign up to get an invitation to the Zoom room social hour by following the link in your weekly update or the link provided in the live stream chat. Through the live chat, we can express love and care for each other. Please take a moment now to welcome each other and to welcome anyone who may be visiting into this morning's service. Once again, we're glad you've chosen to worship with us this morning. Let's say the chalice lighting words together. May the light of this flame illuminate our tradition of seeking, invite all who yearn for acceptance, and ignite our passion for justice and peace.
This is a song by Pat Humphreys and Sandy O of the band Emma's Revolution. It's a great song for singing along. It's called Keep On Moving Forward. Once you got it for the whole song.
I'm using my magic harmony.
Gonna keep on moving forward. Keep on moving forward. Keep on moving forward. Never turning back, never turning back. I'm gonna keep on loving boldly, keep on loving boldly, keep on loving boldly, never turning back, never turning back. Keep on walking proudly, keep on walking proudly, keep on walking proudly, never turning back, never turning back. I'm gonna keep on singing loudly, keep on singing loudly, keep on singing loudly, never turning back, never turning back. I'm gonna keep on moving forward, keep on moving forward, keep on moving forward, never turning back, never turning back.
Today's service is inspired by an essay entitled The Overdue Awakening by Justin Whirlin. The essay appeared in the June 22nd issue of Time magazine. Our reading is taken from that essay. The notion of systemic racism, once confined to academic and activist circles on the left, has become the phrase du jour, with Google searches for the term rising 100-fold in a matter of months. And mainstream conservatives like former President George W. Bush joining historically moderate Democrats like Joe Biden in embracing the term to call for a national reckoning. The spreading recognition highlights an even starker dividing line in America. On one side, a growing majority of the country is increasingly ready to repudiate its history of structural racism. On the other, many of those in power, especially at the White House, are eager to deny it. This is no surprise. By definition, systemic racism is embedded deep and wide across American society, and therefore can't easily be rectified. But for many of those who've spent their lives fighting for racial justice, this is a moment of reckoning that has been a long time coming. Not everything that is faced can be changed, James Baldwin wrote. But nothing can be changed until it is faced. Here ends the reading.
In prayer, led by Henry and Jason Delaney.
First, we bow to honor the spirit of life. We lift our arms and embrace the gifts of spirit. We bring these gifts unto ourselves with gratitude and breathe and smile. We share these gifts with the world. We remember to be present. Honor, embrace, gratitude, share, be present.
Let us put hands on hearts. Feel the warm connection. Let love in this moment flow. Say to yourself silently, I will love myself. I will love others. And that love will heal the world. At this time, we acknowledge the joys and sorrows of this congregation. You are invited to type the names of people you are holding in your heart this morning into the live stream chat. Bring them now into this holy space by typing their names. As humans have gathered for millennia, so we gather on this day to gently surrender to something beyond ourselves, to humbly acknowledge our mistakes, to ask forgiveness, to seek hope and renewal, to honor the earth that supports and sustains life, to remember that all beings are inextricably and mysteriously connected. Now, we still our bodies, and we still our minds. We take in a deep, big breath, and then we exhale. We relax into this space that our intentions make sacred. We enter into the wise silence.
One more prayer. We will say one more prayer. Till every prayer is shared by everyone, we'll say one more prayer. One more song, we will sing one more song, till every song is sung by everyone, we'll sing one.
The difference between the lived experience of UUs and the lived experience of a Christian is most glaringly that we don't have a holy book. This leaves us cobbling together stories and holy lessons from the news, literature, sacred texts from around the world, as well as our own lives. We create meaning by holding up the lens of covenant and principle to these stories. Congregational polity, or the individual church's right to choose for themselves, is more than making our own rules or even choosing our own ministers. It's also about weaving together a collection of stories that inspire our unique congregational journeys. These stories serve to communicate our collective values, both to visitors and to reflect them back on ourselves. Time for All Ages is when everyone in our community is imparted with the exact same lesson. We submit this next piece to the mosaic of UUCA sacred texts. Pie is my favorite dessert. What I love most about Hair Love is that it's layered, like pie. On the very top layer, there's a story about a family who is struggling through a difficult change in routine. Dad, who loves natural hair but doesn't know how to style it, is left to prepare his child's full head of hair. He uses guidance from Mom's YouTube channel to navigate his way to a great hairstyle. And little Zuri restores Mom's confidence by showing her that hair isn't what makes you beautiful. When you sink your fork a little bit deeper into the filling, you find a very UU message. Our first principle is the inherent worth and dignity of every person. That means that the first thing we want people to know about us is that we believe that each individual is love-filled, lovable, and worth care. You might say, well, that's obvious. But to some people, it isn't. Some people don't feel that you should that everyone should have the exact same pie experience. I sit in a chair and eat my pie with a fork. My dad needs to warm his pie for optimal dessert enjoyment. A toddler needs to sit in a booster seat and, depending on the person, might need to eat the pie with their hands. And some of our friends need pie brought to them in order to enjoy a slice. We all need our own unique setup to enjoy the same pie, and that's great. That means that our life is full of people with interesting stories to share. I said that the story is like a pie, and I meant it. When you hit the very bottom layer, it's just like the top. When you go through all the layers, you find that the story is about me, and that I matter, but also that the story is about you, and all of your friends, and your family. How holding space for a story about me and my family, or Zuri and her family, ensures that stories about all of us will never get lost. It ensures that every story is seen, heard, and held in our hearts. If I matter, then everyone matters. What I've been talking about here is equity. It replaces the idea of equality by saying that everyone shouldn't get the same thing, but instead, folks get what is needed to have the same experience. It works even better in the opposite. Equitable generosity is already such an important part of our lives. A baby's laugh is as important of a gift as a friend buying you dinner. Zuri's hand-drawn picture was as moving to her mother as the flowers and affection given by Zuri's father. When we give from a place of equitable generosity, we're giving from a place of authenticity, of realness. And I dare to speak for the entire community by saying, those are the gifts that we desire. For guidance on how to provide the financial gifts that serve to support and sustain our community, go to uuca.org/give. This morning's offering will now be given and gratefully received.
You can be amazing, you can turn a phrase into a weapon or a drug. You can be the outcast or be the backlash of somebody's lack of love. Or you can start speaking up. Nothing's gonna hurt you the way that words do when they settle beneath your skin. Kept on the inside with no sunlight, sometimes the shadow wins. But I wonder what would happen if you say what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave. What you wanna say, and let the words fall out. 'Cause honestly, I wanna see you be brave. I wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I wanna see you be brave. I wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I wanna see you be brave. Everybody's been there, everybody's been stared down by the enemy. Fallen for the fear and doesn't disappear and bow down to the mighty. Don't run. Start holding your tongue. Maybe there's a way out of the cage where you live. Maybe one of these days we can let some light in. Show me. How big your brave is, say what you wanna say, and let the words fall out. 'Cause honestly, I wanna see you be brave, say what you wanna say, and let the words fall out. 'Cause honestly, I wanna see you be brave, and since your history of silence won't do you any good, did you think it would? Let your words be anything but empty. Why won't you tell them the truth? And say what you wanna say, and let the words fall out. 'Cause honestly, I wanna see you be brave. Say what you wanna say, and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave. I wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I wanna see you be brave. I wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I wanna see you be brave.
And now, please join me in the dedication of our offering. To the work of this congregation, which is weaving a tapestry of love and action we call community, we dedicate our lives, and these are our offerings.
I didn't exactly lie. I just didn't tell the whole truth when the police car pulled me over. I was driving 75 or maybe 80 miles per hour on a stretch of freeway where the speed limit was set to a safe 45 miles per hour because it was a construction zone. I'm a neuropsychologist, and I examine and rehabilitate people with traumatic brain injuries, most of the time because of motor vehicle accidents. So I tend to respect speed limits. I especially respect speed limits in construction zones because I've seen the damage a speeding car can do to an unprotected road worker's brain and body. But this morning, I was speeding, and the traffic cop had me dead to rights. There was no use denying the truth of my excess propulsion this morning. I was late. I was very late. The traffic was heavy. I was going somewhere I had never been before, and as I often do, I'd gotten lost several times before I locked onto the right path. It was a path intended to take me to the courthouse door. Ironically, I was already heading to court, scheduled to testify in a death penalty hearing. As the police officer approached my car, I glanced at the official-looking file that was sitting next to me in the passenger seat. It contained notes for what was to be my expert witness testimony, the testimony that I was supposed to be giving at this very moment in front of the judge, the jury, the attorneys, and the family members, all of whom were still a full hour away. That's how late I was. Judges don't like it when you're late to their court. I was truly more afraid of the judge I had yet to meet than I was of the white police officer standing now at my car window. "You in a hurry?" the officer asked, in what under other circumstances I would have thought was a fake Southern drawl. Not hesitating even a moment, I blurted it all out. "Yes, sir, I am in a hurry. I'm an expert witness. I'm supposed to be testifying in court right now. It's a death penalty case." I pointed to the official-looking file in the passenger seat, and then I added, because I thought it would help, "The person killed was a police officer." Now, that wasn't a lie. It just wasn't the whole truth. And it did help. The traffic cop didn't bother to take my license. He didn't ask me to get out of my car. He didn't run a computer check on my license plate. Instead, he returned to his vehicle, pulled it in front of mine, turned on his flashing emergency lights, motioned me to follow, and escorted me to the courthouse door at 75 miles per hour. I hadn't lied. I just hadn't told the entire truth. It was a death penalty case. The victim was a white police officer, and the perpetrator was a black man. He was a drug addict, a thief, and ultimately a convicted murderer. And I was late for my testimony. All this the traffic cop knew, but what he did not know, and what I did not tell, was that I was there to testify for the defense, to testify for the convicted murderer's plea for leniency on the grounds of diminished intellectual capacity, to support his attempt to escape a death sentence. I was there to save a life, not to get revenge for the life that had been lost. To say that Black lives matter and to mean it is to say the hard thing. They matter all the time. They matter not just when that black life is educated, degreed, well-spoken, upstanding, inoffensive, law-abiding, non-threatening, and smiling. Black lives matter all the time, just like everyone else's. You don't have to be perfect for your life to matter. You can be uneducated, non-degreed, and barely able to string a sentence together and still matter. You can be criminal, threatening, and angry, and still matter. because that is the kind of society we've chosen to create for all of us. We are to be judged not by how we treat our most exalted, but by how we treat those whom we judge to be the least among us. If Black lives matter, they must matter all the time. I don't care how many times you've been arrested or what you've been arrested for, you don't die with the hard knee of indifference pressed against the soft, vulnerable flesh of your neck. You don't die like a deer in the headlights of a pickup truck just because you went jogging in the wrong neighborhood. You matter all the time, and yet we, Black men and women, do continue to die in these and other most inauspicious ways. Don't say Black lives matter if you don't mean the hard thing. The hard thing being that Black lives matter all the time, just as your life matters. I wonder when we say it, if we're saying the whole truth. I wonder if we are choosing, just as I did with that traffic cop, to leave part of our story out. I wonder if we mean the whole hard thing. That is the thing I resolve to mean. And I will ask you to join me in that resolution. I will ask you to join me in meaning the hard thing when you say that my life, that my Black life matters. For it is not something that I need to earn. It is not something that is gifted to me. It is a privilege of my birth, a privilege that flows from my mere existence. To be human and to be alive is to have the privilege of mattering. Can I get an amen? Don, I didn't hear much. I think some people may be a little confused by the technology we're using this morning, which is understandable. We've had some glitches. Technology is complicated. Some of you probably think that we are on the Zoom machine. We are not. We are on the YouTube machine. What that means is that in order for me to hear you, you have to speak up. So let's try again, but louder. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Okay, I heard that. That was better. Remember, we're on YouTube, so let's keep the volume up. Regardless of whether a sermon is in person, on, or on a remote platform like this, for me, the sermon always begins not with an idea, but with an emotion, a feeling that I want to capture and communicate, and perhaps even to engender in you who are listening. There are many emotions that I've been feeling in recent months. First, sheltering in place from the pandemic, and then watching the horrific video of George Floyd having the life choked out of him. So many emotions. Too many, in fact, for this one sermon. This sermon could have been about despair. I have certainly felt despair at many moments during the past weeks and months. Despair over George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, and others who've lost their lives in altercations with police. Despair over Ahmaud Arbery, and before him, Trayvon Martin, and others whose deaths never made it into broad public consciousness. Despair over a president who seemed as incapable of compassion and empathy as he is adept at the politics of denial and disintegration. But more than anything, I have felt despair over the American people. Though I was born here, though I grew up here, though I went to school here, though I speak the language and read the newspapers here, I cannot understand and I despair over a people who can elect and even revere such a monster. Though cheered by the polls suggesting the margin of majority is shifting away from Trump and all he represents, I still despair over the large minority that have not turned away. Yes, there were empty seats at the Trump reelection rally in Tulsa, but there were filled seats as well. And every place taken in that hall of misery is a seed for despair. But this is not a sermon about despair. This sermon could have been about anger. I get angry every time someone believes that whiteness comes with the privilege of lynching with impunity. Never in my most testosterone-crazed frenzies would it occur to me to grab my gun and follow someone who looks suspicious. Who does that without even a moment of hesitation? Who does that without even an ounce of trepidation? I know with certainty there would be a voice in my head saying, "Fool, what are you doing? This is illegal. This is going to ruin your life and put you in jail. Put down that gun, foolish man." The absence of that voice in the minds of some who hold the privilege of whiteness is what makes me angry. I also get angry over what we all now refer to as the talk. You know, that conversation that Black parents have when their sons and daughters reach puberty, if not sooner. That uncomfortable conversation that isn't about the birds and the bees, but rather is about how to survive the policing of Black America. I get angry because it is inevitably a conversation about how to bow down before power. An earlier generation was warned to step off the sidewalk to let white people pass, to avert your gaze, to say yes, sir, and yes, ma'am, to answer to boy and girl, even when grown, and to auntie and uncle, even when obviously of no relation. The contemporary talk is but an updated version of those earlier generational messages about how to get along with people who want to kill you, and who can do so with impunity. I get angry because even in 2020, the talk we Black parents give our Black youth isn't about self-respect, it is about self-preservation. The talk isn't about living with dignity, it is about surviving in its absence. It isn't about holding your head up high, making eye contact, speaking with pride and authority. It is about keeping your hands visible, making no sudden moves, and saying yes, sir, and yes, ma'am. How little has changed. This talk could be from 1920 or 1820 as easily as it is from 2020. I'm not suggesting we martyr our children. The time to speak truth to power is not when you are staring into the barrel of a service weapon. The talk remains as important today as it was a century ago, but don't expect me to not be angry about it. But this is not a sermon about anger. This sermon could have been about exhaustion. Institutionalized racism is exhausting. It is like that stain you can't get out. It is a stain so tightly fused to the fabric of American life that it has become the color of America. I get exhausted thinking about my mother's generation, that hardworking, self-sacrificing generation that toiled in America's factories and fields, that fought America's wars and was rewarded with this: a Social Security system founded in 1930 to alleviate the poverty of old age, but that at its inception excluded domestic and agricultural workers. At the time, 2/3 of Black Americans were domestic and agricultural workers and were excluded. My father's generation, that hardworking, self-sacrificing generation that toiled in America's factories and fields, that fought America's wars, and was rewarded with this: exclusion from post-war mortgage lending programs while simultaneously segregated into redlined neighborhoods. Home ownership and the rising value of one's property have long been the primary means by which average Americans accumulate wealth. The systematic exclusion of Black Americans from this source of wealth means that a raging river of racialized disadvantage flows from our parents, flows through us, and still drowns our children. The average Black household has an accumulated wealth of $17,000, while the average white household has accumulated $170,000. The hard work of generations of Black labor leading to such a disparate outcome. The truest believers in the American dream ending in such a nightmare of disappointment. That feels exhausting. But this is not a sermon about exhaustion. By now, I'm sure some of you are exasperated enough to be typing in the chat, what is this sermon about? Well, bear with me. I'm almost there. There's just one more thing this sermon could have been about. It could have been about hope. Despite all that came before, hope is one of the things that I have been feeling. You know what gives me hope in these despairing, angering, and exhausting times? It is the shifts I see in America. These shifts happen every once in a while. The shift from British colony to independent nation. The shift from slavery to abolition. The shift from manifest destiny to indigenous nationhood. From keeping her barefoot and pregnant to universal suffrage, birth control, and the right to choose. The shift from the casting couch to pound me too. From a nation in which Black people could not vote to a nation that twice elected Barack Obama. There's no predicting when such shifts will occur, and yes, they're often followed by reversals that take us tragic steps backward or perhaps even wrongwards, if that were a direction. But I see one of these shifts happening now, and it gives me new hope. It is not just Black people protesting police brutality. Sometimes the protest crowd is majority white. The white people joining those protests, pulling down those Confederate statues, demanding that police departments change or be defunded, or even change because they are defunded, those white people are not acting from their reality, they're acting from my reality. It is Black reality that moves them. I've even found room in my heart for George W. Bush, something I never had while he was president. He acknowledges systemic racism, something the current president could never do. America is shifting. America is at one of those rare and precious inflection points, and that gives me hope. But with apologies to those of you that I am exasperating, I must say yet again, the sermon is not about hope. But now, I am at last ready to say what this sermon is about. The sermon is about resolve. Be it resolved that UUCA, that is, you and me, be it resolved that we will rise up. Rise up from this hot bed of rest and never lay down upon it again. Be it resolved that we will not bring that All Lives Matter sign to a Black Lives Matter demonstration. Would you bring a Colon Cancer Matters sign to a breast cancer rally? No. No, you would not. You would not, because it is beside the point. Rise up. Be it resolved that you will not presume to say what people of color want if you've not talked to people of color. And if you've talked to me, you've not talked to people of color, you've talked to person of color. Person of color does not equal people of color. Rise up. Be it resolved that you will grasp the arc of Unitarian Universalist history. We are not people in the tepid middle. We are people of the burning edge. You do not advocate the abolition of slavery from the middle. You do not participate in the founding of the women's movement from the middle. You do not found the Red Cross from the middle. You do not give the world Louisa May Alcott, Bella Bartok, Alexander Graham Bell, Buckminster Fuller, Margaret Fuller, Oscar Hammerstein, Nathaniel Hawthorne, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, Herman Melville, Sir Isaac Newton, Florence Nightingale, Linus Pauling, Paul Revere, Carl Sandburg, Albert Schweitzer, Mary Shelley, Henry David Thoreau, Frank Lloyd Wright, Whitney Young Jr., and innumerable other scientists, artists, and social justice pioneers who make up the vanguard of every generation in U.S. history. You do not give the world these people from the middle. And right here in Atlanta, you do not stand arm in arm in defiance of hate, prejudice, and injustice from the middle. You do it from the burning edge. That is the arc of our history. We are not gadflies. Some of you are hard of hearing, so I say again, we are not gadflies. We are fireflies. We light the way. Rise up. Be it resolved that you will not get sucked into pedantic discussions intended only to distract you from what matters. Freedom of speech is not imperiled in the United States. The freedom to vote is. Freedom of speech is not imperiled in Unitarian Universalism. The moral imperative to care about more than the sound of your own voice is. Now, while I may be a liberal progressive, I do love conservatives, both in our nation and in our faith movement. They are necessary in a sound democracy and necessary in a sound faith. It's just that these days, it's hard to find a true conservative. Stoking racial hatred is not conservatism, it is demagoguery. Making college campuses emotionally unsafe for black and brown children, and I don't care that they're over 18, they are still my children. Making those campuses unsafe by the tenor and tone of your discourse is not conservatism, it is abuse. Refusing to wear a mask during a pandemic is not conservatism. At best, it is irresponsibility. At worst, it is idiocy. Conservatives aren't riding around in golf carts shouting white power to black people. Those aren't conservatives, those are racists. If you're going to be a conservative at UUCA, for God's sake, be a real one, not one of those phonies. Rise up. And to end where I began, the defense lost that court case I was late for. I did get there in time to testify, but it was not enough. The death penalty was imposed. I and others on the defense team lost that day, but I will not lose today. Be it resolved that you will not ask why we care about black men and women with criminal histories when they're gunned down. We care because a life does not have to be angelic to be holy. We are the religion of inherent worth and dignity, first, last, and always. May it be so resolved. Say amen so I can hear it.
Whew. Tony, we'd be on our feet, a room full of people right here. Thank you for your strong, powerful words. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ayana, for being with us. Thank you all for being here and sticking around with our It is amazing that this is the first time our stream has dropped in the months we've been doing this. It's really great. We actually do pay for the rights to show that video, but YouTube doesn't let you say that. So it's okay. We'll figure it out. If you didn't get to watch the whole video, we were all just sitting here in this room crying and watching it together. It's amazing. It will be eventually in the chat box or in the description of our YouTube service. We'll put both halves together. It'll all make sense later. Our last hymn is a powerful hymn about resolve. It's called I Know I Can. Sing loud.
storms and burdens weigh my heart. Though troubles wait at every turn, I know that I can. Troubles wait at every turn. I know I can go on. My sister in my heart, my brother in my song. Though troubles wait at every turn. Oh, I know that I can go on. And though the journey is long, the destination is near. Though troubles wait at every turn, oh, I know that I can go on. So, cousins, take my hand, and siblings, sing. Hope awaits at every turn. Oh, I know that we will. Yes, I know that we will. I know that we will go on.
You're done. You congregations function so independently that they quickly forget that there are other UU organizations out there. We're often lacking a national identity as UUs. For our spiritual takeaway, I'm going to challenge you to rise up by joining one of these UU organizations that are fighting the fight of anti-racism, anti-oppression, and multiculturalism within our faith. Links to these organizations are in the live stream chat. If you are a person of color, consider joining DRUM. That stands for Diverse, Revolutionary, Unitarian, Universalist, Multicultural Ministries. It is where African American, Latinx, Asian American, Indigenous Americans, and other persons of color meet and organize for collective action and support. Our own Ayana Kafi Stringer is the president of DRUM, and I know you want to support one of our own in her first presidency. Mm-hmm. Her first presidency, not the last, of a national UU organization. If you're Black, consider also joining BLUE, Black Lives of Unitarian Universalism. BLUE is creating safe virtual and physical spaces where Black UUs can congregate, grow, and worship together. If you're white, consider joining R, Allies for Racial Equity. This would be a concrete and tangible way of partnering with UUs of color in the hard work of creating a beloved community. Consider participation in these organizations not as an addition, but as an extension of your membership in UUCA. Your involvement in these national UU organizations helps to keep our congregation on the map as a center for Unitarian Universalism in the South. Our benediction is taken from the 19th century author, Orison Swett Marden, whose philosophy was profoundly shaped by both Abraham Lincoln and our own Ralph Waldo Emerson. I paraphrased and updated the language for gender inclusivity. Martin writes, "History furnishes thousands of examples of people who have seized the occasion to accomplish results deemed impossible by those less resolute. Whole-souled action can sweep the world before itself. As we extinguish our chalices here and at home, let us go forth to change the world. Go in this sacred resolution."